Tonight on NewsWatch, did Health Secretary nominee Kathleen Sebelius try to cover up donations from a controversial abortion doctor?
Plus, President Obama touts his economic policies as he points to signs of a turnaround.
And should teens be arrested for sending sexually explicit content on their cell phones? One state is questioning the laws. All this and more tonight on NewsWatch. President Obama's health secretary nominee is facing new questions tonight about donations from a late-term abortion doctor. Good evening, I'm Lee Webb.
And I'm Wendy Griffith. Kathleen Sebelius has already been heavily criticized by pro-life groups because of her abortion record as governor of Kansas. Now she's under fire for not disclosing all of the campaign money she received from controversial abortionist George Tiller. But will this new development be enough to derail her nomination? CBN White House correspondent David Brody is following the story and joins us now from Washington with more. David, what's the reaction there?
Well, Wendy, senators are definitely going to want some straight answers from Sebelius on this. A senior Senate Republican aide now telling CBN News that this is a transparency issue as well as a life issue, and something Republicans are certainly going to want to know more about. And one prominent social conservative leader believes that the undisclosed Tiller donations have changed the landscape of the Sebelius nomination.
Since she was nominated, pro-life groups have zeroed in on Kathleen Sebelius's abortion record as governor of Kansas. Their list of complaints is long, including her relationship with late-term abortionist George Tiller. In her written questionnaire submitted to the Senate Finance Committee overseeing her nomination, Sebelius was asked by Senator John Kyle about her financial connections to Tiller. She originally disclosed $12,450 in donations from him, but it turns out she left out $10,000 more that she received from Tiller and $13,000 from Tiller's abortion clinic. That equals about three times as much as her original disclosure.
I think this changes the landscape of the Sebelius nomination.
Family Research Council President Tony Perkins tells CBN News this new information is troubling. Health and Human Services Department officials say the Sebelius omission is an oversight. Perkins is highly skeptical.
I'm not sure that it was an oversight. The fact that she reported contributions from Tiller himself, George Tiller, an individual, but conveniently forgot to report contributions from an abortion clinic. It's a big difference. While he's an abortion doctor, receiving money directly from abortion clinics, some would call that political blood money.
A spokesman for Senator Charles Grassley, who is the ranking Republican on the Senate Finance Committee, told CBN News, quote, "The committee proceeds with a vote on a nomination when the senators are reasonably satisfied with the nominee's responses to questions for the record. The senators are reviewing the responses to hundreds of questions for the record from Governor Sebelius. The corrected response and explanation for the correction to Senator Kyle's question will be part of the mix when they come in." Sebelius's defenders say she's been unfairly targeted. They say as a Catholic, she's personally against abortion, and her supporters say she signed bills that promoted adoption and prenatal care.
They're not really looking at her record honestly. You should know that abortions have declined 10% in Kansas.
During her confirmation hearing, Republican senators didn't make too much of an issue about her abortion record or her relationship with the late-term abortion doctor. But Perkins believes that may now change.
It raises the question is, what else has she not told us? What other things remain in Sebelius's closet? What other alliances are there? What other political contributions may have tainted her decisions as governor? These are questions that I think that are running through the minds of many senators right now.
Well, as for a response from the White House, an administration official tells CBN News that these donations are all a matter of public record, so there was no intent to mislead or be difficult. It was simply a mistake in looking over the financial documentation. Now, this is the second time Sebelius has had to explain herself to the committee. Earlier, she had to correct her tax return information because of improper deductions. Wendy?
Well, David, where does the Sebelius nomination go from here?
Well, Wendy, here's how it lays out. The expectation is that the Finance Committee is going to vote on her nomination later this month. Democrats, of course, outnumber Republicans on the committee, so she should get out of the committee, no problem. Then it goes to the full Senate. And unless this new Tiller information becomes a PR nightmare for Sebelius, she should get through there, too. You know, Wendy, it's really going to come down to Senate Republicans coming out in a block against her, but so far it's too early to tell if that's going to materialize.
All right. Thanks so much, David Brody.
All right. Thanks, Wendy.
Stocks saw a drop in prices despite President Obama's progress report on the state of the economy. The Dow dropping about 140 points to close just above 7,900. Analysts say the decline came as a result of an unexpected drop in retail sales, challenging the notion that the recession may be leveling off. President Obama says the economy still faces serious challenges, but is starting to show, quote, glimmers of hope. John Jessup has more from Washington.
The president gave his economic outlook to a receptive audience, receiving a warm welcome on the campus of Georgetown University. Billed as a major speech on the economy, President Obama struck a balance in measured optimism.
There's no doubt that times are still tough. By no means are we out of the woods just yet. But from where we stand, for the very first time, we're beginning to see glimmers of hope.
He took aim at critics who said he's taken on too much all at once, pointing out what appear to be promising signs in home and auto sales and consumer spending. The president also pledged that his administration would continue to work on multiple financial fronts to fight against a deepening recession.
So our most urgent task has been to clear away the wreckage, repair the immediate damage to the economy, and do everything we can to prevent a larger collapse.
Since taking office, the Obama administration has worked to inject capital into American banks, retool housing, offer a lifeline to cash-strapped auto manufacturers, and sign the $787 billion Economic Recovery Act into law.
President Obama wants to take credit for the turnaround and attempt to show that his policies are working. With funding filtering to communities across the country, stimulus spending is starting to show its first effects.
If the stimulus package didn't go through, we'd probably be laying off.
But with huge government deficits, it's unclear just how much the spending will help or hurt in the long run. Highlighting the need for sweeping reforms, he referenced Jesus' Sermon on the Mount and the parable of the wise and foolish builders.
We cannot rebuild this economy on the same pile of sand. We must build our house upon a rock.
The rock, according to Obama, would consist of new rules and regulations for Wall Street, along with major investments in education, renewable technologies, and health care, and savings in the federal budget to bring down government debt. Still, Mr. Obama warned that 2009 would be a difficult year, with more job losses, more home foreclosures, and more overall economic pain before things get better. John Jessup, CBN News, Washington.
Thanks, John. Tomorrow is April 15th, the deadline, of course, to pay your taxes. But it's also Tea Party Day. Thousands of Americans are planning to attend some 500 Tax Day Tea Party protests around the nation to voice their opposition to rising taxes and out-of-control government spending.
Rick Tyler joins us now. He is president of Renewing American Leadership and spokesman for former House Speaker Newt Gingrich, and he's been involved with organizing tomorrow's Tea Party protest. Rick, as you know, the major news organizations seem to be ignoring this story. They apparently don't think it's that big of a deal. Will they be surprised, you think, tomorrow about the number of people who are showing up?
Well, I think they'll not only be surprised, but as we saw today, the Homeland Security Department is actually intimating that these rallies are formed by right-wing radicals and white supremacists. And I'm very disturbed that the administration would use a department that's designed to keep us safe for political purposes of characterizing people of faith, men and women who would like to see lower taxes, would like to see limited government, and would like to see more take-home pay for themselves as somehow white supremacists or extremists. And I think it's very disturbing. But I would encourage everyone to go to teapartyday.com and find out where a tea party is near you. And I think they will be surprised at how many people, families will show up, not intimidating anybody, to show their support for the family budget.
Rick, what do you think tomorrow's tea parties will accomplish?
Well, you know, what's going on, and it's actually, it's a genuine grassroots movement first started by Tax Day Tea Party folks, but I believe that the Reagan coalition is actually reassembling itself. That is to say, social conservatives, fiscal conservatives, national security conservatives, and frankly, Democrats who voted for Barack Obama who are not happy with the direction of this country. I mean, we just talked about $180 billion worth of stimulus, then $345 billion worth of stimulus, and then another $700 billion worth of stimulus, and each one has failed over and over again. What the American people want is lower taxes, limited government, and more freedom. freedom. That is what this country is built on. And the rock that Obama talked about just in the last clip is not the government. It is the rock that the economy stands for is free enterprise and the American people left to their own devices to be innovative, build their companies, to secure our future. It will not depend on the government. The government cannot get us out of this fiscal mess.
Rick, going back to my first question and your answer about the perception from the government that these folks might be white supremacists, are you concerned that left-wing groups might try to infiltrate the Tea Party protest tomorrow and start something?
They already have. I mean, the Huffington Post is recruiting citizen reporters to go out and report on the Tea Parties, and I suspect they're not going out to report what's happening to the Tea Parties. They're going out with a specific agenda in mind to discredit the Tea Parties, to characterize them as people who, you know, who lost the election, people who, you know, who are part of the Bush administration, who voted for McCain, and they're just unhappy. But that's not who these people are. These people are people that wanted change, but we're not happy about the change that they seem to be getting. And this change is having an impact on their family budgets and is having an impact on freedom and is having an impact on religious liberty.
Well, CBN News will be there to cover it and cover it objectively. And Rick Tyler with Renewing American Leadership, thanks for being with us.
Thank you.
We appreciate it.
Democrat Al Franken has declared himself the winner in the disputed Minnesota Senate race. His announcement came after a Minnesota court ruled that he won the most votes in his 2008 race against Republican Norm Coleman. But the battle ain't over yet, as they say. Coleman says the recount was not conducted fairly, and he's planning to appeal to the state Supreme Court. After the recount in a 7-week trial, Franken holds a slim 312-vote lead.
A new climate bill making its way through the House of Representatives has a provision in it that would allow anyone to sue businesses or the government if they think they've been harmed by global warming. Environmentalists say the bill is written that way to try to force the government to curb carbon emissions. But others say it will open the door for anyone to sue over anything.
It's an insane bill designed to protect nobody other than lawyers. And what's the one group that pretty much everybody in Congress it belongs to is lawyers. So it's silly environmental legislation designed to ultimately cost ordinary people a lot of money.
The bill was written by Democrats Henry Waxman of California and Edward Markey of Massachusetts.
Coming up, legalizing sexting. We'll tell you which state is considering exempting teens from obscenity laws. Plus, how Texas Christian University has come under fire for trying to create gay and lesbian dorms.
The doctor said to me, "Peggy, you don't understand. Pancreatic cancer is inoperable and incurable." And he says, "Well, Peggy, you've got 2 months to live." It was like he was telling me, "Go to the store." There was no compassion. And that was heartbreaking. My life was an hourglass. I was home laying on the couch, just dying. My sister Pam called the Cancer Treatment Centers of America. When I got there, I knew that I was going to be cared for. I met with a doctor after the tests were done and said, "How long do I have?" And he looked at me and he said, "Peggy, we did a lot of tests on you, and I never saw one thing stamped on the bottom of your foot that said you were gonna die in 2 months. You have no expiration date." And I thought, wow.
Cancer Treatment Centers of America is unlike any other cancer hospital, full of hope, committed to your fight. We use every weapon, surgery, chemotherapy, radiation, nutrition, spiritual support, and mind-body medicine. We surround you with a real team, working together, all under one roof.
Each time I went back to the Cancer Treatment Centers of America, I responded better. My tumors were shrinking, came back in September again, and they still couldn't see anything. I said, "You're kidding me." We'll see how it goes. We'll keep testing, but we can't see the tumors anymore.
Please call the number on your screen to speak with an oncology information specialist and receive a life-changing information kit and DVD packed with valuable information. Call now and learn about treatment options you may not even know exist.
It's really unbelievable how one doctor can tell me I have 2 months to live. And then I go to the Cancer Treatment Centers of America and they saved my life. Hope is a mainstay. Hope is everything.
Don't give up. Your fight is our fight. Call Cancer Treatment Centers of America today.
Focus on the Family is staging a protest outside the San Antonio Express newspaper. The ministry says the paper refused to publish this ad, which promotes its annual Love One Out conference. The weekend event is designed to help Christians deal with issues of homosexuality in a Christ-like manner. In the ad, Jeff Johnston shares how he was set free from same-sex attraction. It's a story Johnston shared with CBN News 12 years ago when we met him and his wife at a similar conference. CBN News spoke with him today by phone.
Initially, like I said, they didn't give any reasons, and then they said they didn't want to offend the gay community. So evidently they're catering to that audience, and in the process, they're showing their own intolerance of those that have a different message, that have a gospel message that God loves you and God empowers you to change.
We called the publisher of the San Antonio Express News for its side of the story. Our calls have not been returned.
Texas Christian University is backpedaling on previous plans to offer separate housing for gay and lesbian students. The university's new housing community was scheduled to open this fall for homosexual students and their supporters, but TCU's plan created a heated debate, and now they're putting their plans on hold. Many students have weighed in.
That's also starting off as, well, we're different, so we want to live together. So that could definitely create lots of problems on campus.
While I understand some of what they were facing, I'm also disappointed because I know a lot of students were excited for it.
TCU's chancellor says the university, quote, will maintain its longstanding commitment to the inclusiveness of all people. Texas Christian University is affiliated with the Disciples of Christ Church.
Sending sexually graphic pictures and video via text messaging may soon be legal for Vermont teenagers. It's called sexting, and under current child pornography laws, teens can be sent to jail if they're caught sending the images, even if it's consensual. But the Vermont legislature is considering a bill to make sexting exempt from that law. If the Vermont law, or the bill passes, rather, the state would be one of the first to give teens legal protection. Sexting is on the rise across the country.
That's right. Tonight, CBN's George Thomas tries to find out why do kids do it and what can parents do to stop it.
If a boy meets a girl, I don't know, he has a girlfriend over summer break or something, and then he just comes back and he shows like all his boys the pictures that he's been sent, naked pictures. No one gives it that much thought, really.
With many teens carrying cell phones these days, it's easier than ever to take the pictures and quickly share them on the internet.
Somebody might send it to somebody else's phone, and that person like has Facebook on their phone, and they automatically like upload it to their like Facebook or MySpace.
The sheer number of teens sexting is staggering. 15% of teens surveyed said they have sent sexual photos via cell phone. 49% of teens and young adults say they have sent suggestive texts or emails. And 66% of girls who did so say they did it to be fun or flirtatious. But the racy text messages sometimes have harsh consequences. In fact, all over the United States, authorities are beginning to charge teens as sex offenders. Many of those prosecuted are charged with having child pornography after they post the pictures.
I don't think that is what was contemplated when the laws were written. We're now running into high school students getting swept up in these charges.
So what's a parent to do to help their kids stay away from sexting? Therapist Dr. Linda Mintel tells parents to keep a close tabs on their kids.
Look at all their places they are on the internet and check. And I think you should randomly check. Yeah. I'm a big believer as a parent of grabbing the cell phone every once in a while, clicking through some of that history and seeing what's been done.
Tough love. Good for you, Linda. We have more resources for parents on our website. Just go to cbnnews.com and look for the Navigating Kids Through the Text Generation headline.
Up next, Captain Richard Phillips prepares to reunite with his crew and return home, while Somali pirates strike again, taking even more foreign hostages.
CBNNews.com. News you want, when you want, 24/7. Stay current with up-to-the-minute stories.
David Brody, CBN News, Capitol Hill.
I don't have to wait for my news anymore.
CBNNews.com, at your fingertips all day long.
I only watch the stories I want to see.
I find the story, I click on it, and boom,
I'm there.
I'm Chris Mitchell reporting from Jerusalem.
The source for your news, CBNNews.com.
Imagine relaxing to the world's most beautiful music. Imagine 100 of the most soothing melodies of all time. Now, Time Life proudly brings you 100 classics for relaxation on 5 CDs for a very special price. You'll hear more than 5 hours of masterpieces by the world's greatest composers. Call now to get 100 classics for relaxation on 5 CDs for just $24.99. But wait, order in the next 10 minutes with your credit card and we'll cut the price to just $9.99. That's right. You'll get 5 relaxing CDs for the incredible price of $9.99. Then preview other beautiful classical CDs. Satisfaction guaranteed. So call now and get 100 classics for relaxation on 5 CDs for just $9.99.
Call 1-800-625-1585 to order 100 classics for relaxation on 5 CDs for just $9.99 plus shipping and handling when you call in the next 10 minutes with your credit card. Call now.
The shipping captain held hostage by Somali pirates will return to the U.S. Wednesday night. Captain Richard Phillips and the crew of the Maersk, Alabama, will be reunited with their loved ones at Andrews Air Force Base in Maryland. Meanwhile, Somali pirates have hijacked 3 more ships in the Gulf of Aden. A Greek bulk carrier and 2 Egyptian fishing boats are the latest targets. The International Maritime Bureau says there have been 77 pirate attacks this year so far, just 77 since the beginning of the year. 285 crew members are still in the pirates' hands. President Obama is promising to work with nations around the world to end the crisis. But a former Navy SEAL says that will be easier said than done.
It is still an extraordinarily difficult problem to combat. It's almost impossible to patrol such a vast area effectively. And ultimately, the solution's not a military one. It's a nation-building one within the lawless area that is Somalia.
Warships from nearly a dozen countries have been patrolling the Gulf of Aden and nearby waters for months.
The White House is calling on North Korea to stop its provocative threats. The communist country has vowed to restart its nuclear reactor and to boycott international disarmament talks. The latest threat from North Korea comes after the United Nations Security Council unanimously condemned its April 5th rocket launch. The council now plans to expand its sanctions against North Korea.
Protest leaders in Thailand have called off their demonstrations after days of chaos in the capital city of Bangkok. Several days of clashes left 2 protesters dead and more than 120 injured. 4 of the protest leaders have been taken into police custody. A Thai political analyst told CBN News that the prime minister should dissolve the government and call for new elections.
It would be an act of sacrifice if he does that to clear the slate. And if there are this kind of deep-seated doubt that could lead to instability, then dissolving the house certainly is one way to release pressure and move forward. We just have to make sure that the playing field is level, the conditions are in place so that we have a workable and acceptable polls. Otherwise, the polls would be problematic and we would end up in the same place all over again.
The current government has only been in power for 4 months. You can follow any updates to the story at CBNNews.com. We'll be right back.
I enjoy sharing stories from the 700 Club, but my words don't always do them justice. But now I have a better way of sharing them. Go to CBN.com's Media Center. Find the stories you want, hit the mail key, type in your message, then just send it. It's a great way to share 700 Club stories and bless a friend. How cool a club is that?
Imagine growing tomatoes as big as grapefruits, 20 slices from a single tomato, or how about 60 pounds of tomatoes from just one plant? Introducing the tree tomato from Gardener's Choice. It zooms to an amazing 8 feet tall or more in just 90 days. Loaded down with more tomatoes in just 1 week than most plants produce in an entire season. Juicy red vine-ripened tomatoes as big as grapefruits, weighing up to 2 pounds each. This lush 8-foot tree tomato is a virtual tomato factory with a new crop of tomatoes each week. Tree tomatoes come in an easy-to-plant pre-seeded professional nurseryman's pack. Call now and you'll also receive 3 of our big early tomatoes as our gift to you. Just pay separate shipping and handling. These hybrids yield red, juicy jumbo tomatoes by July 4th. You get it all. That's 3 tree tomatoes and 3 big early nurseryman's packs for just $10. Call now.
Call 1-800-498-1571. Order during this special TV offer and receive 3 tree tomatoes plus 3 easy earlies for just $10 plus shipping and handling. Call 1-800-498-1571.
Do you dream about a beautiful landscape or vegetable garden but dread the work? The lightweight and easy-to-handle Mantis Tiller will help you realize those dreams without the backache and blisters and in a fraction of the time it takes to dig by hand. Other tillers are heavy and hard to handle, but the 20-pound Mantis won't wear you out. And don't let its size fool you. This rugged unit has lifetime guaranteed tines, tough enough to cut through sod and churn the hardest soils, allowing you to plant with minimal effort. And we guarantee the tines for life against breakage. Plus, these optional attachments make this little workhorse useful all over your yard. The Mantis Tiller's features and 5-year warranty help it to earn the Consumer Digest Best Buy rating. You'll love what the world's favorite tiller can do to transform your yard, or we'll give you your money back.
Get the power to grow it yourself. Call 1-800-939-8996. That's 1-800-939-8996.
If you missed any of today's news, visit cbnnews.com for all the top stories. Here's a quick look at today's most clicked on stories. Why can't I sleep? The causes and some cures for insomnia. Pastor Rick Warren cancels an interview with ABC News. You can find out why. And more on the Tax Day tea parties all over the country tomorrow. You can see these stories and much more on our website, cbnnews.com. And finally tonight, Unity Through Music by Way of the Internet.
Musicians from around the world are coming together to perform at Carnegie Hall in the first ever YouTube Symphony Orchestra. YouTube set out several months ago to form a complete orchestra by way of the first ever online auditions. 3,000 people submitted video performances, but only 90 were chosen. And of that 90, none has ever performed together until now. They will have 3 days of practice before their joint debut later this week.
Wow, 3 days. And in Carnegie Hall, I mean, that's not a lot of time
to get it
together.
Well, they sound good. I'm sure they will be.
It.
Yeah,
if they're
absolutely.
That good, I'm sure they can. Well, that's all for this edition of NewsWatch.
Remember, you can email us your comments and questions at newswatch@cbn.com. And we hope you'll join us next time.
Bye-bye.